There's a woman who occupies a unique place in Chinese history. Her name is Wu Zetian, and she is the only woman ever to have sat on the imperial throne as China's official ruler. Although the story of this remarkable woman is well known in China, many details of her life remain shrouded in mystery. It's the year 684 AD. In a Yangzhou eating house, scholars and officials get ready to sit down to dinner. But there's a darker purpose behind this dinner party. A plot. A plot to overthrow Empress Wu Zetian. It is the second largest revolt in the Tang Dynasty after the Anlushan Rebellion. But it's a revolt that comes to nothing. Far from threatening her rule, the Empress emerges stronger, her prestige enhanced. This weak woman knows how to wield a sword when she has to. A key figure in this rebellion is a poet named Luo Binwang. His call to take up arms against Wu Zetian plays an important part in encouraging 100,000 people to join the revolt against her rule. However, far from outraging the Empress, Wu Zetian is impressed by this call to take up arms against her. It is a well-written piece, and she can tell that the man behind it is clearly very talented. Instead of rebelling, he should be working for her. The Prime Minister finds himself blamed for overlooking this talented poet and scholar. According to Luo, Wu Zetian isn't just a usurper who has stolen the throne of China, she's also an evil born on the wrong side of the bed. Wu Zetian is illegitimate in more sense than one. So what exactly do we know about Wu Zetian's background? A memorial hall stands in Wu Zetian's ancestral home in Wang Shui County, Shanxi Province. It dates from the time of the Tang Dynasty and was restored in the year 1145. Wu Zetian rose from humble beginnings. Her father, Wu Shiyue, was a timber merchant at a time when the social status of merchants was not high. However, the rebellion against the Sui Dynasty gave the family a chance to climb the social ladder. Wu lent his support to Li Yuan, who became Emperor Gao Zu, the first ruler of the Tang Dynasty. Wu was given a post in the government as a reward and was also presented with a new wife, the second daughter of Sui Dynasty Prime Minister Yang Da. Wu spends the next few years moving between Luoyang, Sichuan and Yangzhou, and it's in this period that his wife gives birth to a little girl who will one day become Empress Zetian. But exactly where she was born remains uncertain. Wen Shui, Luoyang, Chang'an, Guangyuan and Yangzhou have all been suggested. But nobody knows for sure.
I personally believe Wu Zetian is not born. 叫吴世活，吴世活本人呢就在这军队面身为军官，具体负责军需的。当时呢，他的前任夫人已经去世了，他见到了隋朝皇室杨达的后裔杨达的女儿。那么杨达的女儿呢，就给吴世活在洛阳成婚。但是呢，后来呢，吴世活到外地去做官。 按照隋朝和唐朝的规定，一个人到外地做官是不允许带夫人的。因此，武则天的母亲并没有离开洛阳。无论吴世活是在四川做官，还是长安做官，还是扬州做官，实际上武则天的母亲并没有去。因此，无论他在哪里做官，武则天都生在洛阳。 并且这是一个传统观点，不是现在的新观点。并且在唐朝文献中，这个武则天的母亲，她的家住在哪个地方，她有明确的记载，就是隋唐洛阳城的教业里。
However, other cities in China also stake a claim. Discoveries made by archaeologist Guo Moruo in the 1950s seem to support the idea that Guangyuan is the true birthplace of Wu Zetian. In July 1954, Mr. Guo Moruo left Beijing to examine a stone tablet that had just been unearthed in Guangyuan's Huangzi Temple. The tablet bears the name Guangzhang, and it appears to date from the late Tang Dynasty. However, interpretation of the inscription on the tablet is disputed by scholars. The first inscription claims that during the Jin Guang period, which began in 627, Wu Zetian's father Wu Shuye was governor of the prefecture. This much is uncontroversial. However, the sentence goes on to say, so she was born, and the characters that follow are unclear. Guo Moruo interpreted them as in the prefecture. On Guo Moruo's reading, therefore, Guangyuan is the true birthplace of Wu Zetian. Back in ancient times, Guangyuan was known as Lizhou, and because of its position in the mountains on the northern rim of the Sichuan Basin on the upper reaches of the Jialing River, it's long been regarded as a strategically vital strong point. It's here that the provinces of Sichuan, Shanxi, and Gansu meet, and it guards the way through the Qinling Mountains. It's therefore no surprise that an important official like Wu Shuye was sent here to serve as governor. But the question is, did he take his family with him? Certainly, Guo Moruo's interpretation of the tablet inscription suggests that he did. And if he did, Wu Zetian was born here and not in Chang'an. However, the question of her true age also raises questions over her true birthplace. Historians have traditionally relied on works like Comprehensive Mirror for Aid in Government and The History of the Tang Dynasty for details of Wu Zetian's life. According to these accounts, she died in the year 705, aged 82. And if these accounts are accurate, that means she was born in the year 624. Her father, Wu Shuye, was Minister of Works in Chang'an in that year. So, what evidence do we have to support the idea that Wu Zetian was indeed born in Guangyuan?
那么这个问题就也困惑了郭沫若。那么郭沫若在文章里面就有一句原话，就是说这里面还有一种可能性，就是武后的生年有问题。那么到底有什么问题呢？郭老他也没有时间和没有精力来解决这个问题。
Chen Yang is a Guangyuan-based scholar who's devoted his life to the study of Wu Zetian. He believes he can explain why traditional historians got her date of birth wrong.
那么通过我们这么多年的研究，我们发现这里面确实有问题，因为后来我们用了大量的证据，我们证明了武则天她原来没有活到这个八十多岁，她实际上只活了七十多岁，她应该出生在贞观二年，也是公元628年。 为什么就是欧阳修、司马光这些大文学家、历史学家在新旧唐书、资治通鉴里面都认为他活了这个八十一、八十二或者八十三岁呢？是因为武则天在做皇帝的时候，因为他做皇帝，他使用了频繁的更改年号，啊，他更改了，他执政二十三年、二十一年，更改了十八个年号，啊，那么有的时候一年之位他换改元三次。
The broken tablet with the illegible characters that led Guo Moruo to the conclusion that Wu Zetian was born in Guangyuan also makes reference to a supernatural event that took place in the second year of Jin Guang's reign, 2 years into Wu Shuye's governorship of Lizhou. That story is told by locals to this very day.
正月正月的这个时，大概应该是正月23。广元这个城里面呢，看到天上到处是一片祥云，这个一对凤凰从那个五府的门前一转，围了五府这个房子绕了几个圈儿，飞到东上去了。当天就升了这个武则天。
Strange purplish skies, weird clouds, phoenixes. Together, it means just one thing: someone has been born in that house, who will one day rule China. It was for this reason that the 23rd day of the first month of the Chinese lunar calendar became a special day for women in Guanyuan, a day for women to put work to one side, enjoy themselves, and pay tribute to the extraordinary woman who overcame the prejudices of her day and rose to the very pinnacle of power. The Tang poet Li Xiangyin also associated Guanyuan with the empress. On his way back from exile in the year 851, he stopped in Guanyuan and wrote the following lines at Wulongtan Lake in front of Huangzi Temple, the reputed birthplace of the empress. Yang enjoys herself in the lake in which the dragon resides. They become affectionate with each other. Yang then gives birth to a daughter, Wu Zetian. Li Xiangyin composed these lines more than 140 years after Emperor Zetian's death. But the association of Guanyuan with the empress seems to provide more evidence that she was born in this place. The 23rd day of the first month of the lunar calendar had long been established as a day of cultural importance in the lives of the people of Guanyuan.
后来为什么改成9月1号呢？是咱们1988年，广元市一届人大是通过那么一个议案。跟9月1号是有两个原因：一，咱们广元靠北边，还挺冷，正月23很冷啊，大家玩的不尽兴是吧？你看这都是9月1号的衣服啊，那时候秋高气爽。
所以说每年我们广元女儿节也会开展很多的民间文化活动，游河湾呐、啊，还有划凤舟呀，还有狂欢夜呀等等很多的活动。举办这个活动主要的目的，也就是为了展示我们广元儿女的当代的新风采。
So while Guanyuan residents are proud to call the city the hometown of Empress Wu Zetian, and women still row boats out on the lake, nowadays the emphasis of the festival is a more contemporary one. It's not certain where Wu Zetian was born, and in the absence of any conclusive archaeological evidence, it seems that scholars will continue to be divided over the exact location of her birthplace. But there are other things about Wu Zetian that we're not sure about. For example, it's not even clear what her legitimate title is. We know for sure that the name Wu Zetian was not used in her lifetime, nor indeed wasn't used in the period following her death. For a long time, historians referred to her as either Empress Wu, Madame Wu, or Empress Zetian. It wasn't until modern times that the name Wu Zetian came into usage. In the year 705, when the Empress fell seriously ill, her son, Emperor Zhongzong, conferred on her the title the Great Zetian Empress. The name Zetian means corresponding to heaven. It's an allusion to this line from the Analects of Confucius: it is only heaven that is grand, and only Yao corresponds to it. At that point, Wu Zetian preferred to go under the name Wu Zhao. Zhao means the sun and the moon in the sky shed light on the earth. The character Zhao was, in fact, created by the Empress herself. She came up with 19 characters in all, but only this one has come down to the present day. Another name used in her day was Wu Meinian. Again, there's a play on words and an allusion. The name can be read as Wu the Beautiful Lady. This is a reference to something that happened when she was 14. According to the life of Empress Wu Zetian in the Annals of the Tang, when she reached 14 years of age, she was presented at court. There, she caught the eye of Emperor Taizong, who was so bewitched by her beauty that he made her one of his ladies-in-waiting. However, life in the court of the emperor wasn't quite as exciting as this young girl might have hoped. Back then, the emperor had access to 31 secondary consorts and 9 ladies-in-waiting. It seems that the lady-in-waiting, destined to be empress, had a lot of waiting in store for her. The beauty that had brought her to the palace didn't win her the favors of the emperor. She languished in obscurity in the palace for 10 years. Yet it was the boring, dull routine of palace life that laid the foundations for her future success. She didn't waste her time. Instead, she threw herself into a regime of study that would, in years to come, prove indispensable in government. Life for the future empress changed dramatically when Emperor Taizong died. All the consorts and ladies-in-waiting who hadn't been favored with the attentions of the emperor were sent to a priory where they were to become nuns. Wu Zetian was one of the neglected consorts who was ordered to pack up her things and leave the palace for the Ganye Temple in Chang'an. And there she led a quiet life wrapped up in the intricacies of Buddhist thought, copying out sutras. But just as she had in the palace, she turned this dreary, sequestered life to her advantage. She began to write poetry, and one poem regarded now as a Tang Dynasty classic changed her destiny. It reads, "I'm worried that I mistake red for blue. I look pale because I miss you too much. If you don't believe that I shed tears for you, you may look at my dresses in the trunk."
这首诗在唐朝的诗人里头应该算是一个二类作品。二类作品很多人一听就觉得这不算什么，可是唐朝的诗人，那是一种什么样的水准呢？唐朝号称诗国呀，唐朝是诞生李白、杜甫的时代呀。你绝对不能认为武则天这首诗可以达到李白、杜甫、王维、孟浩然这个水准，但是它有它的好处，好处在于哪里呢？它这个感情非常的真挚。 表现得很大胆，而且又非常的形象。看朱成碧四纷纷，什么意思呢？我心思恍惚，所以把红的都看成绿的了。憔悴之离，卫懿君，我为什么如此心不在焉，如此精神恍惚啊？是因为我在想你呀、啊！哎，这是一种很大胆的一种表白啊，而且很形象，把红的都看成绿的了。 然后不信，比来长下泪。如果你不信，我最近经常为你流下眼泪的话，开箱艳曲石榴裙。你打开我的箱子，看看我的石榴红裙，上面是不是已经点染了斑斑泪迹？The
poem is entitled "Wishes of a Woman." It's a love poem written to Li Zhi, Emperor Gaozong of the Tang Dynasty. Before Wu Zetian left the palace, she and the Crown Prince Li Zhi had fallen in love with each other. When Li Zhi read the poem, he was deeply moved. After all, he loved Wu. He acted on his feelings and decided to bring Wu Zetian back to the palace. The various titles conferred on her, from Meinian to Zetian, express different aspects of her character and development. It's also important to bear in mind that her record in the official histories is a mixed one. She is praised and blamed in equal measure. For example, in his novel The Flowers and the Mirror, the Qing writer Li Ruzhen draws attention to the dictatorial side of her character. In the novel, he has her arrogantly issuing orders for flowers to bloom. According to the novel, it's the depths of winter and the flowers obey. All that is, except the peonies. Such is her displeasure that she has all the peonies cut down and burnt and then sent to Luoyang.
挪那木兰的花那干都是黑色的，传说都是武则天把那把木兰焚烧了以后，都把它烧焦了以后变成黑的。像这个是都是一种传说，我觉得这就是它应该是跟了这个气候啊或者环境都有关系。但是人们把这个传说都按专家的这个按在这个武则天的头上，到底是真是假，这都也不太好说。但有了这个传说以后，人们更愿意看它，更愿意仔细去观察这东西。你比如说现在我冬天去看木兰干，你仔细一看，它就是黑色。
These black-stemmed peonies are peculiar to Luoyang, and they're the favorite subject of local painters.
So, 大家都喜欢木兰，它历朝历代都去画木兰，写这题这题，因为木兰它象征着繁荣昌盛、欣欣向荣。大富大贵，这个他有这个寓意。
In many ways, a woman like Wu Zetian was an obvious target for critics. The very fact that she had risen so high posed a challenge to the feudal values of the day. Naturally, she became an object of scorn for the conservative male writers of the day.It's also important to remember that the episode in The Flowers and the Mirror, in which she orders the flowers to bloom and punishes the disobedient peonies, was based on one of her own poems. That poem reads, I will visit the garden tomorrow, tell spring to come immediately, it must come tonight, without waiting until tomorrow morning. The poem was written in the year 691, a year after Wu Zetian became empress.It can be interpreted in many ways. It could express a simple yearning. Equally, however, it could be seen as a knowing self-reflection on her resolution in politics, her determination and desire to get things done. Back then, resolution, determination, and decisiveness were essential qualities for anyone who aspired to rule China. Without them, a ruler didn't have a hope.How did Wu Zetian feel when she was presented to court as a young girl? How, in her late years, did she feel about her life and achievements? What contribution did she make to Chinese history? What drove this extraordinary woman? Please join us.For the next part of Wu Zetian.